Today, I'm going to introduce you to my bachelor project and those conceptions and theories and ideas of virtual and augmented reality. And then I'm also going to introduce you to other mediums or materials, augmented materials, as Lucas here was also presenting. I'm going to introduce you to Unity, for example. And then in the end, I'm also going to share, present different kinds of work that maybe are interesting to you. I will start by presenting this virtuality continuum. And when working with virtual reality or any kind of like work that exists between this physical and virtual realm, it's really good to first understand what that actually entails. And here, this is the virtuality continuum, which connects completely real environments to completely virtual ones. And it's by the two theorists, Milgram and Kisino, that are just giving like a rough idea of how virtual and how real sort of some technologies can be. And as you can see here in the beginning, there is the real environment. At that, there's no technology at all. And like, we need to imagine a time where there's no digital input in our everyday life at all. And in the other end, we have a completely immersive virtual environment, which is totally disconnected from the physical realm. And then we have everything in between. For example, augmented reality exists, but also augmented virtuality. And I think it's important to do a distinction between those two words, because an augmented reality means that you put digital data into a real environment, meaning you know that from, for example, from Pokemon Go, or also what we saw at the presentation before, that we have a through the camera lens, we sort of see our real environment, but then we put a digital input towards that. And it's a bit the opposite at an augmented virtuality environment, where you have a computer-generated environment, but where you put real sort of data from the physical realm into it. So that can be that you see a computer-generated environment, and maybe with a certain technology, you can see then your own physical hands in this this space. So here it is also just to give a little more visual content to what this can entail. At the real environment, the world is completely unmodeled by technological input, and then the other end we have the fake or the totally computer-generated environment, and then there are all these in between. But I'm not going to dive too much into that. It's just to give an idea of when working with these technologies, it's nice to have an understanding what it is you would like to work with. I am very curious of working with this like physical and virtual realms in a way. And for my bachelor project, I wish to work with something very subjective as an atmosphere of a real space, and how can that be sort of stored into a digital environment. And I was looking into some of these theorists where we have Juhani Palasma on the first picture, that is just saying that atmosphere is sort of like the feel of a space. And I was putting that up towards Janard Böhme, who is talking about how actually atmosphere is a relation between the subject in a space and the objectives in a space. So it's something that is actually entirely sort of subjective, but there are also these objective inputs due to, for example, light or the coloring of a space that affects us emotionally in a way. And so when working with like, you know, wanting to store a real space in a digital sort of conception, I needed to lean up towards Edward Sawyer's third space theory, because he is talking very interesting of all the dimensions that are of a space. He was sort of responding to and discussing Henri Lefebvre's theory where he's talking about how space is two-dimensional. It has a physical context and then a sort of conceptual context to space. But Edward Sawyer is talking about how that there's actually a third space, and that's what I'm going to go into here, because he talks about the trialectics of being and space. On the first picture here, what sort of like determines our existence is spatial sort of framework, historical sort of framework, and social sort of framework around us. And that can be put into how we also understand space that is around us. So for example, the first space is what he determines is connected to our spatial being. It's the perceived spatiality, which entails that is a space that where you enter a space, or you are at a space where you only perceive its sort of like objective like dimension of it. You understand, for example, in this space, the light is a bit orange and red. It's warm in here. There's a certain acoustic also, and so forth. So it's this like immediate relation to a space. Then there is the historicality or the conceived space, meaning that it's what urban planners or others are like determining. It's the concept of a space. So for example, this space is not only with orange light or there's a certain acoustic. We are also at Rhythmic Musikkonservatorium. It's a school. Here we learn about music and the production of it and so forth. So that is the idea of it. And then there is the third space, the sociality of the space, the lived space, where everything sort of comes together. And an example of this is that how you perhaps know that on the street there are these like areas where people are supposed to walk, or for example down at Christianshavn station, you're supposed to be there momentarily and wait for the bus or the metro, but the space is used in another way by, for example, people hanging out there and sort of creating a social sort of dimension to it, a meeting spot. So that is what like how we can understand space. And I'm just telling this because I think it's interesting to myself, but I also think it's interesting to when wanting to work with technology and using that into the realm that we are in. So it's just a nice tool to have in the back of your mind when thinking of, okay, why is it interesting to do a work like this at this specific spot? Also, Edward Sawyer is just saying in the end about the third space that it's like the Aleph by Louis Borges, capable of being seen from every angle, each standing clear, but also a secret and conjectured object filled with illusions and allusions, a space that is common for us all, yet never able to completely being seen and understood, an inimaginable universe. So it's where it comes together. It's just interesting to think of how these like existential sort of like parameters are also projected into the space that surrounds us in a way. I made this quick overview to understand like these conceptions of Edward Sawyer. Also, I would like to talk about Roy Ascott, both an artist and theorist. He wrote many interesting texts in the end of the 80s and the beginning of the 90s, thinking about the beginning of cyberspace and internet and so forth. He had all these very beautiful and interesting ideas and hopes for what internet can be used for. He was talking about telematic art, you know, the use of online computer networks as an artistic medium. He was just very fascinated by the thought of how the use of technology is suddenly a space for a common conception for people all over the globe. So suddenly, internet becomes a common collective mindset. He also says that computer networking leads to the amplification of thought, enrichment of imagination, broader and deeper memory. It's sort of computer networking is an extension of human senses. And he said that the goal of our time is to make the invisible visible. And that can be also very confusing what that actually means. But on the next slide, I have a clip here by Roy Ascott where he says something.
Technology comes out of desire. I mean, I've never seen technology as something that's been inflicted on us. I think we desire to do certain things. For example, we've always desired to communicate telepathically. I think looking at late 19th century in America and Europe is a good idea. Maybe in Japan, I'm not sure of the history, where there were many mediums and there were lots of seances, they were called, where people had table wrappings and they had things, marvelous things called apports. An apport was, the way it worked was you had a little box on the wall with a curtain that you closed it off, and then everyone would sit around in this seance, and then a form would materialize in the box. So if you put wet plaster in the box, you would get the imprint of a child's hand, or a feather would appear, or something which was supposed to have been transported from another realm. But look at it from our perspective, and we're talking about telepresence, we're talking about virtual reality, we're talking about telecommunication. All these things which, through technology, we are realizing, were talked in, and if you look further back to the shaman of the ancient culture, and if you look in Brazil now, for example, to the shaman also transports, you know, telepresence, is involved in a virtual reality. I think it's not a foolish relationship, connection to make.
So I would just also like to read of this quote from one of his articles where he asks himself, is there love in the telematic embrace? And it just pinpoints very much what his texts are about. So he says that telematic process, like the technology that embodies it, is the product of a profound human desire for transcendence, to be out of body, out of mind, beyond language. Virtual space and data space constitute the domain previously provided by myth and religion, where imagination, desire, and will can re-engage the forces of space, time, and the matter in the battle of a new reality. So my bachelor project is called Holsteinische Straße 24, and it's an address in Berlin. It's referring to my grandmother's old space. She died in 2015. I was just very curious of this idea of grief and the idea of loss, and not only loss about people, but also loss of space in a way, because as time goes and through time and gentrification processes and all these things, spaces are just transforming and thereby also the atmospheres of those. So I was interested in how can I ask myself about how I could use technology to store something, to archive something as a human, as an atmosphere, as a digital file that you then later can enter again. So how can you archive a specific time and place? I did this with the basis of the atmosphere that we just talked about, where I understood, okay, so atmosphere is something that is subjective. Okay, so that means that me conveying some characteristics of a space is part of like supporting that idea, that conception of that atmosphere. Atmosphere is perhaps not only something about sound and smell, but also the conceptual sort of understanding of a space, the third space perhaps also. So what I did here is you see a map, which I did, where I set up the space, like physically, or like how it the size of it, I mapped that out. And in that space, I was mapping sound files. I was mapping memories that I had recorded, that I have of specific places within this law space of my grandmother's room. So this is what you see here, that I'm mapping out these memories that are sound files. And in the middle of the space, there is this radio, because connected to this space, my grandmother was always listening to a certain radio channel. So it's also to have that as a like background sound. So how can people enter it? And there I thought that there was an interesting relation between like this digital archive, but also how can I use, like, how can I transform that into like something people can enter? So I made use of Unity, where I created this like one-to-one build up of this room, where you can see that inside of this sort of digital space, I have mapped sound files, which through technology or through the VR technology, one can enter. I'm going to talk about that a little bit. But this is what I did, where I could sort of like create like a digital space as I wanted to. The reason that you also see that there are these walls is that it's possible within Unity to give these walls certain material characteristics, meaning, for example, that the floor was wood, the walls were concrete. So these sound files, they would actually get this sort of like acoustic in the space that actually then would create this like feeling that you would enter a real space, even though it was not existing. So at my bachelor project, I marked on the floor the one-to-one size of this existing space. And through this virtual setup, in each corner, there would be these readers reading sort of like one's position in the space with help from this tracker. So every participant that would enter the space would have a wireless headphone, and they would have a tracker placed on the head. So when entering this like digital space, one would have a feeling of entering another space than is actually what you see there. So what is happening within this space is that this participant or this viewer, listener, would enter the space. And with the help from the tracker and the Bluetooth headphones that are communicating back to a system and giving another output all about where your position is, you would have a feeling that there are these sound pockets in the air. So you would walk around and you would have a feeling that something is whispering over there, and you can go closer, and then you have a feeling that there's this air sound pocket that you can listen to closely. And this setup with the VR system is like not that very like practical in a sense. It entailed not only the reader and the tracker as parts, but also I had to have a whole stationary computer for it, having the program sort of like working. So it's not that flexible in a way. So, but it worked very nicely. A year after, I did a new experiment at an exhibition where I tried to rethink how I could make use of this app that is available for everyone, actually, which is this sound, augmented reality sound app, where you can very easily, with a device like an iPad, for example, that with the camera lens is reading the room in a way. And then with help from the camera lens, the app would then, you with the app could then be able to place sound files in the space and map that out. So I thought that was very perfect to my project. I couldn't understand why I haven't thought about knew about this technology before instead of setting up a whole VR system. So I tried to do that at this exhibition, where people very easily and flexible could walk around with an iPad where everything was containing. And I also did, as last time, was marking the floors. So it's this and like one-to-one installation as I also did at my first project. So, and here on this picture, you can get a little glimpse of where the sound files are. There would be these like small light spheres that you would then see and then could go over to and then listen to with the headset connected to the iPad.
Wasn't that of a pleasant experience? The floor was all covered by a rough coconut carpet. If not what looked like Persian carpets were lying on top of it. My grandmother's colorblind imprint on paper sector that was once white. The picture lit the child after my grandmother snapped.
And illustrating people who left their work at the local market.
I remember constantly if there was a standing called Mary Cox. There was a picture of another open book.
It was standing and just pages. The book is called Diana's Book and written by Herbjørn Vassmo.
I would just like to say that the system is not that good to use for exhibition setting, but perhaps it's a good tool to test out like ideas of like when wanting to place sound files sort of in a space like this. Here there's also the promo video of the app, so you can see how it works. It's very simple that you place sound files like this and you can decide how it should look in the air. And here she decided it should look like stars or so forth. And you can place it anywhere because, as I said, it's using the camera lens, the app. So it's by that it's getting this spatial feeling that adapting to it. But it's not working super perfectly, I must say. But it is possible. Just Fields, it's called. It's so simple. It's an app called Fields. It's very simple. Yeah. So when you get closer to the sphere, it gets louder. So you have the spatial feeling of getting. These are also air pockets and our sound pockets, as I also presented in the Unity project. So yes. But it's good. I must say that it's not perfect. I would rather use Unity when wanting to present something to the public. I would say Fields is much better to use just to test out quickly. It's very easy to just test out quickly placing how does it feel, because it's difficult when saving the installation you have built up in Fields. It's not saving it really good. It's like you want to insert it again, and in the space that you have saved it in, sometimes it would have like changed 180 degrees, and suddenly the whole sound installation is up in the air or like in the wall. So it's not good for for presenting to the public, but as test. This guy, he is just really good at explaining how to work with augmented reality within Unity.
Welcome to this first workshop on augmented reality in Unity 3D using the Vuforia plugin. Today I wanted to show you how you can use physical image triggers, image targets like this, images that you can print out as triggers for virtual content that is being displayed on it. So here we have this idea that these cracks that you see in roads all around you, this is actually in front of our building in the parking lot, that these cracks can actually trigger your imagination, and they can be the starting point for certain things that may come out of them or may grow from them. So since we're in the Midwest here, I thought a corn plant, a corn stalk, would actually be quite interesting to come out of them.
Also, you can work completely different with technology. Actually, you don't need all these complicated sort of technological devices to work with this within the virtual and physical sphere. You can do as Janet Cadiff did with her project, her long black hair, which is an audio walk, which takes the listener through Central Park's pathways, in the 19th century, where the listener is sort of retracing the footsteps of a woman. I just think it's very inspiring to think of how this work is a complex sensory investigation of location, time, sound, and physicality in a way. And it's about also this like interweaving stream of consciousness, observations, fiction, local history, music, and other atmosphere and cultural elements. And then the workers have photographs in their hand that they also are asked to take up. There is also this work of Janet Cadiff, where she have created a video that people can watch at the place where the video is filmed, you know, being guided through a physical space by a video.
Turn the camera on, press the video button. I'm sitting here right now with you in the train station in Kassel, watching the people pass by. It's very intimate in ways, watching people. You can see how they walk, so you can tell if they're happy or sad or lost somewhere in their mind. This video will be an experiment. We're like those prisoners stuck in Plato's cave. We watch the flickering shadows on the screen. Try to align your movements with mine. Move your screen up to the left as I do. A red coat. I used to have one. Wonder where it went. So many people wear black here. Garbage pails have moved. Do you see the musicians? They're between the pillars now. Let's get up. Follow them.
Then there's also Jeppe Hein, who did the work in Visible Labyrinth in 2005. This installation is a imaginary labyrinth with no physical walls, so that the movement of the visitors is structured and organized by the infrared signals from the ceiling that is forming like a digital invisible grid pattern. So the those people entering the installation, as you perhaps can sense on this picture, they are all also wearing wireless headphones. So because the labyrinth is not a visible or physically tangible object, invisible labyrinth then becomes the installation by the interactivity sort of and imagination of the visitor being guided through this work of art. The same year that I did my bachelor project, there were other art and technology students from the fourth semester, so the year under me. They were doing this installation called The Greenscape by Maros Pekarik, Lucia Paniskit, Trine Störner Westfalen, and Dominique Galea. And Greenscape is an interactive sound installation exhibited in the urban are Karolinelund and Aalborg, where they are increasing sort of the audience's awareness of noise pollution in their sonic surroundings, tracing the movement of the participants, just like my bachelor project, where they are performing then a sound walk through a specific space in the park where different sonic elements are revealed. And then the last installation I would like to show you is the bachelor project of Christina Witt Grønborg, who actually finished her art and technology education the same time as me. So it's also from 2019, where with the project, What Voices in the Waters Whisper Through the Waves, is sort of like an installation that investigates realizations that emerge from experience with products representing respectively the domain of scientific and art. So it's what the work does, as I understand it, is that microphones are placed in water, or like it's sort of conveying the sound pollution that there is in water, that it's not something we can necessarily hear on top of the water, but in the water there's a different frequency. So this is what Christina Witt is doing. Yes, that was actually my presentation about sound art between physical and virtual realms.
Thank you so much, Kamilla. So if anybody has a question out there, please feel free to ask.
Yeah, I was just thinking that all these examples you gave were like focused on installations, and I was just wondering how ways to use it in like other settings, like a band performance, or using, I don't know what I was thinking about, but just I was just wondering if you had any ideas or had worked with something.
When I hear your question, and when I'm thinking about a band normally consists of several sort of sound inputs, and maybe it's interesting in relation to this that you can sort of divide out these sounds and place them sort of three-dimensional. Like you can sort of, I don't know, perhaps it's interesting that each instrument or each musicians are like have their own entities or like inner space, and that you can, maybe it's interesting in relation that the viewer, the listener can step into like a space where these different sounds are sort of set up, or I don't know. I haven't worked with like bands or like performing like that. It has more. I've been very concerned around this idea of the spatiality and that relation of the context that this sort of technology is placed in.
Could I ask a follow up?
Yeah, questions? Absolutely.
Yeah, I was just thinking about: is it possible the examples you have given here, you have to kind of define a space wherein the sounds are placed. But is it possible to use the app and people can use their own living room as the space?
So, for example, when working with Unity, that is entirely set up within the sort of digital program. That's in that in there you determine how things should be placed. But I would say that if you wish to work with Unity with like placing and a sound installation in your living room, it's just a good idea to have an idea of how big your living room is and where things are placed. Map that out first, and then you can use this as a parameter when working with an installation in Unity. But I would then say, for example, when working with fields, which I showed you afterwards, it uses the camera. And here you can very easily just place sound as you wish. I actually, before my project at this exhibition we see at this picture, I was also using my living room as a test study to just see, okay, how does it work and how does it sound when coming back and forth with the sound pocket. So that is possible also.
Any other questions out there? Maria, is that a...
Yeah. Thank you for the presentation. I thought it was really interesting how you were mapping memories. I was just wondering what you were, if you were doing any projects at the moment, what they were about.
I was mentioning before that I'm developing a project for the spring exhibition at Kunsthal Aarhus, where I am making use of augmented reality as a base point. And with inspiration from my bachelor project, I'm just very curious of those discourses that are on the internet around Kunsthal Aarhus or Kunstnernes Påskeudstilling, which is organizing this event, and those the discourses, the relations, the sort of social roles that are between them that you can read about on the internet. So I've been working on this idea of how much space we have as artists through Kunstnernes Påskeudstilling actually are allowed to work with inside Kunsthal Aarhus. So it's about, I'm just working with this political relationship of how much is determination or a good word, you can have as an artist inside these institutions. So what I'm doing right now is that for Kunstnernes Påskeudstilling is that you enter the exhibition where you will receive some iPhones that are the goggles of this installation work, where there are these pinpointers on the walls. So, as also was talked about in the presentation earlier with Lucas, is that there are these visual pinpointers. So when taking the iPhone and then putting it to the pictures, a digital sort of object appear. And here I've been working with the medium of banners. I think it's an interesting medium because, especially in relation to technology, because we know banners from activistic occupation sort of spheres. We know those for these kind of political spheres and mentalities in a way. And there's something interesting about, occupying a space mentally or digitally, but not doing that real life in a way. So that is the sort of interest I'm at. At Kunsthal Aarhus as an institution and their power position they have and to artists in Denmark and internationally also. So it's just and what kind of role they play on the art field and also in relation to what is being said about them on the internet and in Instagram, for example. There are, perhaps you know, there are so many meme pages, and I'm very curious of the one especially that is called Kulturelitære Memes, which I'm not the creator of it, but I just think it's hilarious how they're just like making so much fun of like the art scene in Denmark, and I think it's interesting to take that and place that in the institution at Kunsthal Aarhus, hopefully in the spring. So it's about this like very activistic sort of role, in a way, occupational role as an artist that I'm interested in a way. Yeah, so that, and there, as I said earlier, there I use the visual pinpointers as that people with their iPhones in the exhibition space then can see.
So thank you very much, Kamilla, for coming.
Thank you so much.
It was really an interesting presentation and really nice with the connection also to Lucas before. So nice to see. I can see some hands being raised here, so that's good.
Great.
Okay.